are listening to Hmong FM, where we give you a glimpse into the Hmong American experience on Fresh Air Community Radio, KFAI 90.3 FM in Minneapolis and 106.7 FM in St. Paul, Radio Without Boundaries. I'm Kathy Mouacheupao, and I'm here with my co-host,
Wameng Moua.
And we have a very special broadcast for you today. First, we want to thank Lady J for allowing us a little bit of extra time today. We have all five of the St. Paul mayoral candidates in the studio with us. Actually, we hope to, but we've invited them all here today to kind of kickstart. And I was just, as I was reading all of the about all the forums that are coming up, we're really, really honored to be kind of the kickoff of this this season for you all. So we are going to be talking with our St. Paul mayoral candidates. First, I just want to say that this is not a debate. This is actually an opportunity for us to meet our candidates. I am a lifetime St. Paul resident. When I had the opportunity to buy a home, and I thought about the two cities and just knew right away that St. Paul was the city that I wanted to actually buy a home in. And so I am personally, in a very selfish way, just really excited about tonight and to get to know all of you. We've collected questions actually from our listeners and from community. We actually have way more questions than we're going to be able to ask tonight, but we'll do our best to really represent what we heard from our listeners and from the community tonight. So thank you all for joining us. Why don't we just start off the night, just give you an opportunity to introduce yourselves. Tell us who you are and why you should be the next mayor of St. Paul. We'll start with an easy question. let's start with you, Elizabeth.
Well, thank you so much for having all of us here. My name is Elizabeth Dickinson, and I live on the west side of St. Paul. I was brought up in Massachusetts. I went through the public schools there. And then I went to the University of Cambridge and graduated with a B.Ed. Honors. That's an education degree. I subsequently got my master's in counseling psychology from Lesley University in Massachusetts, and I have a life coaching certification from the Adler Graduate School in Richfield. I believe that I would be the best mayor because I have an ability to bring people together. I have a real commitment to creating a government that is transparent, responsive, inclusive, accessible, and one that will direct the resources of the city more back towards the neighborhoods. I believe that in the last several years, we've been kind of seduced by the bright, shiny object syndrome, kind of going for a lot of large development. And I think that some of the neighborhoods have been neglected. I think one of the first areas that people intersect with the city is through the rec centers, through the libraries, through the schools. And I want to make sure that those are fully funded, that we support those. I think especially for immigrant communities and the fact that 70% of our school children are now from communities of color, and the fact that 40% overall means that in the underserved neighborhoods, one of the first areas that people come into contact are rec centers. I spoke with one of our city council people who said the one thing she had asked for in the budget was for increased funding for rec centers and increased hours, and she was not able to get that. And I think one of the ways that people belong to the city is by creating a sense of safety, by creating a sense that there's programming, by a sense of including them. And I think that that's really, really important. One of the things that I love about St. Paul is all of the passionate, principled people. I'd like to bring them more into the decision making. I'd like to make sure that the mayor's commissions are made up more of a more diverse group of people to represent the neighborhoods to the mayor. One of the things I would like to also see in St. Paul is just a sense that we are preparing our children for the future, and by making sure that they are aware of all of the opportunities that are available to them. One of the areas that I think a lot about is where are the jobs right now, and are we preparing our children for those jobs? And I can see I just have a few seconds left, so thank you again for having us here.
Thank you. That was Elizabeth Dickinson. Tom, Who are you and why should you be the next mayor of St. Paul?
I'm Tom Goldstein. I live in the Hamlin Midway neighborhood. And thank you, Kathy, for having this forum. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. You know, I don't know that anybody should be the mayor, but I will tell you why I think I'll be the best mayor. Primarily because I have, I believe, the broadest experiential background. I'm a law school graduate, so I have a law degree, and am very familiar with, you know, the kind of policy interactions we have around the law. I had a business for 14 years, so I've actually had to hire and fire people and manage an enterprise. I've created jobs. At one point, I had two stores and managed about 15 employees. I think I'm only the only candidate in the race that actually has that experience as a business owner. I've worked as an affordable housing organizer. I've worked within the legal community on pro bono opportunities with volunteers. I served on the school board for 4 years. I'm the only former elected official that has served citywide. And I also worked as a union rep for 3 years, so I've been on both sides of that dynamic. And I think those experiences are very important because in a city, we're facing a lot of challenges. And if we're going to be the kind of city that's really going to emerge in the 21st century, we have to tackle some of the sacred cows. And I think the perspective I bring is as a change agent. I have a long record of speaking out against what I think are dubious or ill-advised policies at the city. As Elizabeth noted, the glitzy projects, and I'll name them specifically, the Saints Ballpark, the planned infrastructure for the soccer stadium, the Penfield project, and now the Palace Theater, while they may be great entertainment venues, that represents almost $170 million that we could use for a whole range of things. And what I'd like to see is a city that actually serves everyone well. There has been long-time disinvestment in neighborhoods, and we need to actually invest in people rather than in buildings. We could create a revolving loan fund to assist entrepreneurs. We could repair our streets. I want to see a St. Paul where we rebuild our infrastructure, where we make our parks and our libraries and our rec centers available to the needs of residents rather than the needs of the city. If that means being open later hours, being open, you know, on Saturday and Sunday with extended hours, we should be doing that. The resources should be appropriated to serve the community. And our biggest need is job creation. We can talk about racial equity and doing equity as a whole, but if that doesn't come with economic opportunity, we're really not going to be able to achieve the things we need. So I need to talk quicker because 3 minutes goes really fast. So we'll get into some of that other stuff later. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. All right. Melvin Carter III. Tell us who you are and why you should be the next mayor of St. Paul.
Well, yes. First, thank you so much for having us all on, and thank you for hosting this show. I think this is an important opportunity for us to talk to folks who we're asking to represent. I'm Melvin Carter. I'm a fourth-generation St. Paulite. Our family has been here for 100 years since my great-grandparents came here as domestic refugees from one of the most violently racist towns in Texas. They packed up their two children and the belongings they could carry and made their way as far as they could from the lynchings that they saw in Texas to the opportunity and promise they saw in St. Paul. Four generations later, I know they'd be amazed at the opportunities that this city has afforded me. I'm a product of our city's public schools, of our city's recreation centers and libraries, who grew up to be a proud dad, a homeowner in our Rondo neighborhood, and vice president of the city council, and currently serving as advisor to Governor Mark Dayton, working on early childhood issues like pre-kindergarten, making sure that pre-kindergarten opportunities are available to every child in our state. I've gotten a chance to grow up in St. Paul and experience a city of great opportunity, and I've also personally experienced a city of discrimination and structural inequity. Those two things create a strong contrast for a city, and I think the biggest challenge to us becoming the city we ought to be and should be. We're one of those families that got displaced when I-94 came in and uprooted our old Rondo neighborhood. My grandfather lost 7 commercial properties when Rondo was uprooted. And so coming from that life experience has given me a passion. It's given me a set of an understanding of our community that's important and has guided my public service for all of my adult career in working on critical issues like education, like housing, like job creation in our community. I know that my family isn't unique. My family exists in a long story of immigrants and refugees who've searched the world to find in St. Paul hope, opportunity, and just a chance for a better life for their children. I believe in that promise, and I love St. Paul too much to just accept this city as is. I'm running for mayor because we have work to do to extend that St. Paul promise to every person in every part of our city.
Great. Thank you. All right, Pat Harris. Looks like you're last but not least, right?
Sounds good.
So tell us who you are and why you should be the mayor of St. Paul.
Well, thank you so much for having this. I love KFAI and the great things you do, so I appreciate it. We all appreciate the opportunity to be here. I also am a fourth generation St. Paulite. Mm-hmm. I grew up in St. Paul. I went to school in St. Paul. I've been active in the community my entire life, graduating from college. I worked as a VISTA volunteer at Catholic Charities and then two more years at Catholic Charities on a homeless employment project where I helped to get homeless people jobs in St. Paul. I then proceeded to work for the Ramsey County Board trying to bring government closer to the people. In that time, I got my MBA at the University of Minnesota, just only steps from where we're at right now, and I joined the business community where for the last 17 years, about 17 years, I've been a public finance professional both at RBC and at BMO Harris Bank. Also in that time, I got married to the fabulous Laura Harris, and we have 4 young children, 3 of which who go to Expo Elementary in St. Paul, and 1 of which is going to start at Expo this fall. So I spent 12 years on the St. Paul City Council. I live in the Highland neighborhood, and at the City Council, I specialized in numerous things like the St. Paul Public Library, where I was a leader on creating the separate library agency and on issues such as the budget and public works and enhancing and promoting public safety in very, very difficult financial times, using my financial acumen to really get St. Paul through some difficult times. Throughout all that time, my wife and I and my extended family has been extremely active in the community, served on numerous boards and commissions, from Catholic Charities to the Children's Museum to Como Friends to the Friends of the St. Paul Public Library, where I served with Melvin as well, and really just had a stake in this community to always look at how we can make things better. And I'm running for mayor because of that sheer passion to make a difference in St. Paul. Public safety, obviously, it cannot be a great city to live and work unless it's a safe city to live and work, and so public safety, I think, is everybody's priority. Jobs, I am proposing one of the most comprehensive and aggressive jobs programs that the city has ever seen through an access to capital program that is very unique. City infrastructure, such as libraries, parks, public works, are all things that we're going to take a very hard look at, do some things exactly as I did as I was in City Hall the last time, which is always going from point A to point B and trying to get things done for our community. So, for me, it's the same passion, and it's the experience that's incredibly unique, and a love for this city that I think will move this community forward.
Wow. Okay. So this is going to be quite a year, I think, for the residents in St. Paul.
Some strong candidates to choose for sure.
And what always happens, actually, is that, you know, every time I ask a question and I get a response, like a thousand at least new questions arise. And so we're going to try our best to to ask the questions that we've planned to today and then, you know, maybe have each of you come on again where we can actually dig a little deeper personally with each of you. But I'm going to pass it over to my partner here.
All right. I'm the fun guy here at HmongFM. So I get to ask the fun questions. We really, like we said, we want to really get to know who you guys are. And so Why don't you guys name your go-to restaurant here in St. Paul? And secondly, what your uncle visits from Texas or wherever, what's the first place you guys bring him to? This time, let's go ahead and start with Tom.
Well, you know, I don't have one favorite restaurant, but I think because I live in the Midway, some of the favorite restaurants I have, Black Sea on Snelling Avenue, Hans Cafe on University, those are probably, you know, the two that I frequent most. And, you know, I try to get over to the east side and other places as well, like Ward 6 on the east side and occasionally in Highland. I'm not a huge restaurant guy, probably more likely to frequent, you know, brew pubs and other things. The river is my favorite part of St. Paul, particularly as you're, you know, Mississippi River Boulevard, biking there, walking there. Some of those sort of cutouts is the likely place that I would take people to visit if they were here. And just the neighborhoods. I mean, that's obviously St. Paul's strength, the fact that we have so many unique neighborhoods, whether it's the east side, the west side, you know, some of the Latino hangouts. And so I generally try to give people, I don't get a lot of visitors, but if I do, take them around to visit the neighborhoods.
I think they're going to be lining up to come now, just giving a list of sure. locations that you've shared. All right, Melvin, where do you like to eat?
Boy, this is a hard question to answer. I like to eat everywhere.
Right.
I think St. Paul is one of the few cities in America where you can get great pho, you can get a good sambusa and burger, whatever you're in the mood for. So my inability to choose just one is one of the reasons my family and friends hate to drive through St. Paul with me, because my favorite places in St. Paul are all of them. I can't drive through without telling them the stories of, you know, my high school, of growing up at Central High School, or, you know, anything else. So I end up all over the place around the city. And when folks come to visit, I end up wanting to show them the city that I love.
Yeah.
Every part of it.
Yeah, there's lots. All right, Pat.
Well, I share that viewpoint. You know, with my Serving Our Troops project, we've gotten to know so many restaurateurs and things like that. And, you know, Mancini's is where we go. We go to Skinner's, and we've been to Skinner's together. A lot of us have. And but I take them to Mancini's. And then I usually got the kids in tow, so we're going to the conservatory, the Como Zoo, the Children's Museum. And you can't forget the Latimer Central Library, which is phenomenal. But just like everybody else, though, it really is these the neighborhoods. I mean, Laura and I do tours of St. Paul all the time for people, big groups and small groups. And every corner of the city is phenomenal. And but like I said, I got the kids with me. We're going to the Children's Museum or the Science Museum or some of these great assets that we have that support our families. And then we'll hopefully have a Mancini steak. Kids love Mancini's, too.
All right. Well, it sounds like, so we've got great neighborhoods. I mean, basically everywhere in St. Paul.
Wait a minute.
Oh,
you didn't
I'm sorry.
Ask me.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, that's right. This rotation.
That's right.
And I'm sorry, Elizabeth.
That's okay.
Please, tell us.
For Mexican food, Boca Chica. Yeah. For right. Palak Paneer, Everest on Grand.
Oh, good call.
For a vegetarian quiche, I'd say Sweet Hollow. For a salmon quiche, I would say Finnish Bistro. So that's sort of, those are the ones that come to mind. For taking people, I would always in the winter go to Como Conservatory because I love the changing flowers that they have there, and the scents are just so beautiful when you walk in there in the winter. And then I would say if I was going to take a walk and I wanted a long walk, I would go around Lake Phelan. And then if I wanted a shorter walk, I would go around Como. And you know, for theater, I would bring people to anything that Nautilus Music Theater did. So I think I've probably come to my end. Yes.
Very cool.
But I could keep going.
Yes. I love our city. Yeah. I really do. So I think this makes me think. So last year I attended Mayor Chris Coleman's State of the City, and he proclaimed 2016 the year of live music, which I think is great. Well, I'll just get straight to the question. I'm going to also try to keep my questions to the questions. I have the tendency to you know, also talk about how great the city is and how things are. So how do you see the role of arts and culture in the city? You know, he actually talks about the impact on economic development, cultural vibrancy. How do you talk about arts and culture? What is the role in the city? Melvin?
Yes. I think arts and culture is critical to who we are as a community and who we are as a city. I actually grew up in St. Paul's arts and culture scene. Some of my earliest memories are watching my mother sitting in the back of Penumbra Theater, watching my mother rehearse for an August Wilson show as one of the original cast members there. I went to St. Paul Central High School, which has a strong arts and culture tradition. I was part of the Central Touring Theater, and we have, you know, plays and musicals and those types of things always happening, and a great band always happening at Central. And it's no coincidence that Central often has some of the most National Merit Scholars in the state. I think our arts and culture scene is a huge opportunity for our city because arts and culture is how we can celebrate, we can share, and we can help to uplift all of the different cultures that exist in our community and celebrate the fact that we're all here together.
Great. Pat?
Well, you know, arts and culture, it's part of the fabric of our community, and it should be supported and celebrated. It celebrates the diverse nature of our community. It gives opportunity for people to grow in our community. It's smart at all levels, from business standpoint, from all standpoints. St. Paul has a cultural sales tax program that's been supporting arts, and that's extremely important to small theaters like the Penumbra or the Minnesota Jewish Theater or some other great theaters, you know, Park Square and all these great places that support our arts and cultural scene, but also music and public art and literature and everything that happens in St. Paul. Part of human vibrancy, I think, is artistic expression. Whether you're driving in your car or on the light rail and you see some public art, you see some of the great stops that we worked on. Mm-hmm. Remember that, Melvin? And, you know, and it's from public art to the theater, to the Ordway, to all these things that that really define a community and make people feel like they're part of something.
Elizabeth.
I'm a former professional union actor, so I've probably lived this. Back in 2003, Ann Markison did a report, and I think she interviewed me on the cultural artistic dividend, like what the arts pay back to society. And it is so much more than it is generally acknowledged to be. And I know that from Nautilus Music Theater, which has helped me bring some of the work that I have written for musical theater and made it live, that and to in the schools, you know, I remember as a kid that if I hated a subject I was in, what really kept me going was the fact that I had an arts class to go to or a drama class to go to. And I believe that there is really potential, especially with the immigrant communities going forward, to establish cultural districts that are immigrant-specific, you know, like Little Mekong, Little Somalia, that those are ways of anchoring a neighborhood and attracting more business as well.
Thank you.
So I can't imagine there's anyone that doesn't appreciate the vitality of arts and music to culture. You know, one of the best experiences that I've had in my professional life is publishing and editing a literary baseball journal for 11 years. Obviously, that's a very limited, you know, audience, but it involves, you know, dealing with writers and book reviews and a whole range of ideas and expressions that I found, you know, between the poetry and fiction and everything else to be extremely interesting. The question talks about the mayor declaring 2016 the year of music in St. Paul. I don't think that's really important. I think we need to support all the theaters and the cultural opportunities in our city, which I don't think you do when you plow $16 million into one venue in which all the revenue is going to go to private operators. That money would have been much better spent supporting all the artistic venues and ventures around town. And I think the STAR grant is a great program, but money has been diverted from there for other issues, and it needs to go back to actually supporting the arts the way it was intended.
So I was actually, sorry, Wameng, I was going to ask a follow-up question, because when the mayor declared that, I had a very similar kind of feeling. You know, I was really curious to to know how he was planning to I mean, my question was, who are the artists? How are communities actually going to access this music? And that's my question also to you then. I mean, I agree everything that you've said. I used to run a small arts organization, and so I know that it was very challenging and difficult for a culturally specific arts organization to really thrive the way that, you know, maybe the Ordway or other larger institutions do. This is an equity question, right? How given the things that you've said about the arts and culture and how it is important to communities, how would you assure that that all communities would have access to the arts, whether it is to participate, to perform, or to see? Who are we?
Maybe
up
just
to?
A 30-second answer for that.
Okay. I think we might be here. And you know, it's how you focus those dollars, and if you can commit, and I completely agree. I mean, using the arts funding that we have to really support the diversity and the incredibly fabulous diversity that we have in St. Paul, making sure you're focusing those dollars citywide to make sure that we're covering and celebrating our cultures, I think is really important. It's how you focus dollars. And there's also you know, percentages in there that you can do in other types of public works projects and things like that, as long as you're focusing and making sure that there's a commitment that you're not just going to give the dollars to the large, you know, heavily funded organizations, but you're promoting, you're going into schools, you're working with community organizations, and sometimes you need to reach out to them and say, you might not know about this funding source, but we're here to tell you about it, and you should be encouraged to apply for it. I think that's very important. I do believe, you know, that needs to be a focus of that funding, and that's a good discussion to have.
30 seconds or a minute? What's that?
Elizabeth?
I think one of the things you have to do is go in and ask the organizations themselves and the people themselves what they need to make sure that you can do what Pat's talking about in terms of focusing the dollars. I mean, I have loved what the Freedom Library is doing on the east side by creating some space in the basement that theaters can use, that dance places can use, because they had enough money to put in a sprung wood floor, which is really important for dancers. I know, because I'm a dancer as well, and you really need that so you don't blow your knees. I love what the Eastside Enterprise Center is doing. You know, they have a little cultural space that's going to be open to people who are working full-time during the day, but they are doing arts with kids at night so that there's a space that they can take kids to teach them Aztec dancing or whatever it is that they want to do. So I think you need to talk to the community. You know, is it space? You know, is it chairs? I know Nautilus Music Theater had to do a whole fundraiser just on, like, trying to get enough chairs. You know, ask them what it is so you can focus the dollars that Pat's talking about.
Thank you.
Well, I mean, I think it's a matter of equity. And equity is that, you know, it's fairness. It doesn't mean that everybody has to get the same amount, but that everybody, that organization should have access. I mean, when we were building the Saints ballpark, I think $1.5 million was pulled out of the STAR funding to go to the ballpark to fill a funding gap. That absolutely should not have happened. It may have been $500,000, but it was clearly money not intended for that purpose, but we considered that somehow that was cultural and the arts. Those are the kind of things we should not do. My ex-wife, Pat, mentioned the Minnesota Jewish Theater Company. I know what theaters struggle to get up and running, and, you know, all the obstacles they have to succeed. That's what we should be supporting. I'm much more interested in supporting the arts in large rather than funneling money into just one particular entity like the Palace Theater, which is a great venue, but that doesn't mean where we should be putting public dollars.
All right. You are listening to Hmong FM, where we give you a glimpse into the Hmong American experience on Fresh Air Community Radio, KFAI 90.3 FM in Minneapolis and 106.7 FM in St. Paul, Radio Without Boundaries. We are talking with St. Paul's mayoral candidates this evening. And right before we left for a small break in a song by Dysfunctional Family called What If, we were just about to hear from Melvin Carter III about about how to fund, how to share, how to do the arts in a more equitable way in St. Paul. Melvin?
Yeah, thanks for the question. All of our communities in St. Paul have thriving arts and culture scenes. Whenever we survey our guests, we always say that our diversity is one of our favorite things about St. Paul. And through our arts and culture scene, we can express that. We can give life to that diversity in all of those different communities. When we do that, and as we do that, it helps us become a global city. It helps us allow our children to understand all the different cultures, the languages, and the communities that exist in our city. And it opens up a real unique set of economic and social opportunities for our city. All of our communities have strong arts and cultural communities. They don't all have equal access to the city funding that supports arts and culture. We have to make sure that we proactively, as a city, go to each community, engage those artists, celebrate the arts and the artists that exist in our community, and see that as an investment that will have a return for a very long time for our city.
Great. Thank you. Lots of things were happening while we were off the air, including our last guest. So Dai Thao is joining us now. So we're just going to actually start from the very beginning with Dai. We had everybody introduce themselves at the beginning. So you just tell us who you are and why you feel you should be the next mayor of St. Paul.
Thank you, Kathy. My name is Dai Thao. I represent Ward 1 on the St. Paul City Council. I want to serve you as mayor because, you know, I know what it's like to be living in a bad government. When I was 5 years old, I saw three of my siblings, my three siblings, pass away on our exile to the refugee camp in Thailand. And I don't want to squander this opportunity to serve and to protect the people of St. Paul, to ensure that we don't have that sort of injustice here and the things that we see happening on the national scene. And there's lots of injustice in our community. There are lots of great things about St. Paul, but the way the resources are allotted into the city of St. Paul, there's an injustice in that, how our communities of color are interacting with police, how our small businesses are scrutinized, and we can do better than that. You know, as an IT profession, I have the skill of taking really complex issue and breaking it down, bringing people together. That's what government should be about, for the people, by the people. And, you know, right now, that's not how it is. Our current government system right now, even in the city of St. Paul, it only works for certain people, certain folks with certain income and certain connection. And my administration is going to be very inclusive. It's going to be the most diverse in the history of the city of St. Paul, so that everybody could be a part of this administration. We have shared problem. We need to come together to find shared solution. I have a track record of working across community, across neighborhood, to bring resources and prosperity into Ward 1. And I like to bring that into the entire city. My work as a community organizer has taught me that even though we come from different history, we share a common destiny, and that our diversity, it's our strength. And you'll hear this again and again from everyone, because that is true. And I also believe that our lives are interconnected. And in order for my kids and my family to have a good life, I have to fight for you and your family first, so that we can all thrive together. And I'm convinced that we can do that. And we're at a very pivotal moment in our history, in our country. And I like to lead us in the direction of prosperity for everybody. As my work on the city council, my work for Earn Sick and Save Time, my work to remove the police off of the civilian review board, my work to ensure that we have paid parental leave. These are just some small, and the responsible banking ordinance. These are just some small example of what I've done, and I will continue to do this as your next mayor.
Thank you, Dai.
All right. We are living in the Trump era as we speak. I mean, I see some heads shaking over there. But honestly, since Trump has been in office, certain mayors all throughout the country have proclaimed their cities to be sanctuary cities. As mayor, would you make such a proclamation? And if so, or if not, what does sanctuary city mean to you? And I believe it is Elizabeth.
Oh. Yeah. Well, I helped work on the original 2004 police INS separation ordinance. So I'm a big supporter of that, which is now called kind of sanctuary cities. I believe that we need to create a welcoming atmosphere for immigrants. I don't believe that the police should cooperate with ICE unless ICE has a warrant. I absolutely believe in the wording, which means that people who are undocumented or immigrants of any kind can apply for city services without fear that they're going to be asked about their immigration status. I completely support that. I actually spoke with Chief Axtell earlier this week, and one of the things that he said that I thought was enormously comforting that I wish more people knew was that he has said that anytime there's any contact from ICE that he wants to make sure that it is all diverted to him and that he personally wants to deal with it. And I think that's very comforting and should be comforting to immigrants.
Thank you. Tom.
We are all immigrants. That's, I think, the message that we need to remember. We are all immigrants to this country, and everybody who is in our midst deserves to be protected. So whether we call it a sanctuary city or some other name, we absolutely should make sure that anybody who is here, unless they're, you know, a serious criminal, that they are protected, and that we are not doing the work, we are not aiding the federal government in this, you know, what I would call is just a really, really unfortunate way that we are approaching those who are new to this country. Immigrants represent a huge cultural and economic engine and benefit to us. They have built this country. You can look at the Hmong community, the Jewish community, the Irish community, the Italian community, Native American, African American, every community has made us a stronger city. And so we need to stop thinking of this as them and us. We are all us, and we need to make sure that we all can live and work and be safe together in St. Paul.
Melvin?
We are a city of immigrants. We are what we are. We are who we are because of the Irish immigrants who came here so long ago, because my great-grandparents came here from Texas, and people are continuing to look across the ocean, to look across the globe, and see its promise in St. Paul. We have to continue to extend that promise in order to continue to grow into the city that we want for our community. I know what it feels like personally to feel targeted by police, and it's not okay for anyone in our community ever to feel that way. We have to make sure that we preserve and protect our most valuable public safety asset, which is the trust and confidence that exists between our community and our officers. That's very critical, and we cannot allow our police to be in the position where they're enforcing federal immigration policies. But we can't stop there either. We have to be creating a city where every person in every part of the city, for wherever they're from, has an opportunity to live with dignity, to access a great education, a good job, and decent housing. That's how we continue to push forward in the context of a Trump presidency.
Well, I share all those viewpoints. I will say that I authored the 2004 separation ordinance in St. Paul. I took it to the neighborhood meetings. I took it to the police department. I took it to the mayor's administration, and I passed it at city council. I was proud to do that in 2004. I'm proud to support it today. Everybody's right. This is a city and a nation of immigrants. My grandparents came to the United States from Armenia. They fled persecution in Armenia to be here, and in St. Paul and in every city, we celebrate immigrants, new Americans, and they're part of the fabric of our community. And instead of doing what's happening in Washington right now, we should continue to embrace people. There are sons, daughters, coworkers, neighbors, friends. We're all in St. Paul together, and I was proud to do that ordinance in 2004, and I think it should remain strong. And you know, definitely.
Thank you. All right, Dai.
I mean, we're living in a very troubling time, and so when Trump was running for office, he proposed that he would ban Muslims from coming to this country, and when I heard that, what I did was I passed a resolution to ban Trump and his bigotry from the city of St. Paul. And you know, I got threats and I got a bunch of stuff that came my way, but you know what? I'm happy to take those hits so that the people of St. Paul don't get hit. And when he implemented the travel ban, I passed a resolution to direct the city attorney and the Human Rights Department to work with any family, any resident from the city of St. Paul that may have been held up at the airport. And that's the kind of toughness and tenacity that I will bring to the city of St. Paul to protect all citizens. And we got to go beyond just the talking nice thing about Sanctuary City. We got to ensure that we celebrate all different cultures and community. And we got to put where our money where our mouth is. And that means that we have to invest in the community, ensure that small business that are owned by immigrants and refugee community have access to capital and resource so they can thrive in this community as well.
Okay. Once again, other questions keep popping up. I'm really curious actually to hear what the specifics are. So how would you, like, what specifically will you do? I heard a lot of things about, you know, so I think we all agree, everybody wants this to be a great city for everybody. Mm-hmm. But you know, there are different ways that people can, that can happen. What specifically will you do as mayor to make sure that, you know, that St. Paul is the most livable city in America for all of its residents? And, you know, you can pick maybe one, because there's probably a list of things. I've heard a lot of different things: jobs, housing, access to parks and libraries. I mean, these are all things that have come up today. You know, what specifically will you do to make it a great city for everybody?
It is the slogan on the website, right? The most livable city in America. So
yes.
What Kathy asked, what would you do to ensure that slogan is true?
Specifically. Give us some examples and to give us an idea of how you plan to work with your administration, to work with people that are in the city. How do you plan to do that? I think we're...
I think...
Did it come back? I'm not sure.
Did I mention the housing?
Should be Tom.
Okay.
Let's start with Tom.
And we'll give
it's
it
not a perfect system.
We'll give
but
it a 2-minute round.
Yeah,
here.
This one deserves some extra time.
So just specifically the most livable city in America, I don't think that really serves us well, because I think it's more of a slogan than something we can really, you know, demonstrate. There's no criteria that establish, and I just don't believe in anecdotal slogans is the way you move a city forward. I think I have a very comprehensive plan. First of all, we have to have job creation. We have to create jobs. People, you know, the recent report that 40% of St. Paul is in poverty should trouble everyone. This is not news. It was 25% just 4 years ago and growing. So the best way to address poverty is to provide a job. That is the quickest way out. In order to do that, we have to have an educated workforce. So St. Paul, we need to, the biggest thing I want to work on education-wise is align city resources so that every school has a business partner, a nonprofit partner, a faith community partner, and that every elected official, everybody is vested rather than on an ad hoc basis. So there are adults that are mentoring and showing the way out for kids. There are opportunities for internships and on-the-job experience. If I were mayor and some business was seeking a subsidy, I would want to find out how many mentors you're going to bring to the schools. How many internship opportunities are you going to provide? Because we have to have an educated, skilled workforce so that kids can go to college, a trade school, an apprenticeship program, or be ready for the workforce. We have to attract businesses here. We have to sell them on St. Paul, and those are amenities that go beyond stadiums and luxury apartments. We need to have our parks and rec centers and libraries. Those amenities need to be stressed, and we need to have hours that serve everyone. We need to have a revolving fund that will allow businesses and entrepreneurs to have access to capital, and we have to pull those things together. Look at something like the Portland plan, how they actually unified a number of ideas to move the city forward. That's what we need to do, is have that comprehensive approach.
Okay. Thanks, Tom. You are listening to Hmong FM, where we give you a glimpse into the Hmong American experience on Fresh Air Community Radio. KFAI 90.3 FM in Minneapolis and 106.7 FM in St. Paul, Radio Without Boundaries. I am your co-host, Kathy Mouacheupao, and I'm here with
Wameng Moua.
And we are talking with the five mayoral candidates for St. Paul tonight. Right before we left for the break, we left Melvin Carter III, and we're asking about specific plans, specific tactics, specific strategies for making St. Paul a great city for everybody.
Thank you so much for the question. I'm running for mayor because of the number of times in my life I've learned how the way we take care of our local communities can speak even louder than what's going on in Washington, D.C. about who's part of our community and who matters in our community. I'm going to be fighting to build a city that works well for every person in every part of our city. That starts with building a safe and well-run city, making sure that our first responders have access to the resources, the tools, and the training they need to be accountable public servants in our community is very critical. Making sure that we are plowing our snow and filling our patching our potholes very well and timely in a way that allows community life to continue forward. I'm going to be a mayor that focuses on education. I focused on education as a city council member. I focus on education in my work now working with Governor Dayton, and I'll continue that focus moving forward to make sure that our city's schools, libraries, parks, and rec centers are all working very well together to support our children and make sure that all of our children get the strong start that they need to succeed in school and in life. And I'm going to be advocating to build an economy that works for all of us. That's going to start with raising the city's minimum wage to $15 an hour. That is very critical so that no one who works full time in our city should ever be stuck living in poverty. And that also includes working to make it easier to create jobs and grow a business in St. Paul. So that those who invest in us know that we're invested in them too. We have opportunities to make it to streamline our permitting and inspections process. We have opportunities to think about how we invest in small businesses, community-owned businesses, our local commercial corridors, and all of these decisions will work well together to make sure that we are building a city, community, and a city government that works well for everyone.
Thank you, Melvin. Pat.
Thank you. I have specifics on a number of priorities that I have for this community and that I think will make a difference in St. Paul, but I'll focus on what a lot of us are talking about, which is jobs. I have a very specific plan that involves, I think, one of the most aggressive and innovative access to capital program that the city and potentially the state has ever seen, where up to $100 million of the city's long-term investment portfolio will be directed into community investing at community banks to small businesses in targeted neighborhoods. We would go from $2 million to nearly $100 million in capital available to small businesses without raising the tax levy. It's an aggressive plan. It's built on my 17 years of experience in the financial industry, and I am confident that it will grow jobs in our community, will grow jobs in our community. It's a very specific plan. I also believe that on public subsidies, we should be very specific about hiring requirements. On city contracts, we should be very specific about hiring requirements in targeted neighborhoods of our community so we can give everybody an opportunity to have a good job in St. Paul, a job where people can grow, a job where people can advance in that job, raise families, buy homes, and continue to grow in our community. So it really is a jobs concept is a comprehensive proposal. It's extremely specific, and it does go hand in hand with education, with public safety. I said it when we started, a great city to live and work has to be a safe city to live and work. And so making sure our public safety professionals have the resources and the staffing that they need so that we can have neighborhoods where people feel safe, where businesses want to locate, where our central business district, people can feel safe and we can grow business in downtown in all of our neighborhoods.
Thank you. All right, Dai.
Can you ask the question again?
Yeah. basically, I'm asking for some specifics, if you have plans or strategies for how to make St. Paul a great city for everybody.
Okay. So to the point of St. Paul calling itself the most livable city, and we all know that it's not, and that is why I think one of the things that, as a mayor, the most tangible thing that a mayor can do and has power over is the budget, right? And so as your mayor, I have a set of racial equity criteria that every decision that we make, how does it promote racial equity? What are some unintended consequences? If we invest all our resources in downtown, what happened to the neighborhood? We have to have these criteria, and we have to make a decision based on this so that we can hold ourselves accountable. Otherwise, lots of people can talk a big game, but if they're not going to put the resources where they think that it, where they say it's important, that we know that it's not going to happen. And so, another thing that we have to work on right away is our right away assessment, right? And how right now it's a very regressive system, where people in Frogtown, Highland, Eastside, we pay more assessment than other folks in other parts of the neighborhood. And this system was set up a long time ago to benefit certain communities and not every community. And so the next mayor need to take care of this issue. And as a city council, I'm already beginning to do this work at the city council to ensure that we have a more fair assessment, so that we can be, so that folks are taxed more equitably across the city when they are taxed. The other thing is that the city of St. Paul, 30% of the property doesn't pay property taxes, and so what we need is a capital city strategy where we can bring in the big business, the university, the nonprofit, the taxpayer, all the stakeholder together to look at the data and to solve this together. There's lots of hard decision that we have to make going forward, and I bring the best experience of the current time, not what happened a couple years ago or not what happened 10 years ago, but what's happening right now, and to work with the current city council so that we can solve these problems together. And I look forward to serving you and doing that work for you.
Thank you, Dai. Elizabeth.
Specific initiatives that I would champion include the $15 an hour wage. I think what they've said in Minneapolis is that would lift 71,000 families out of poverty, and there is no program that anyone here can come up with that would probably do more to help more people than that one initiative right there. I also would support hiring business navigators for the city. Frequently there are complaints that when you come to the city, although individual city departments are helpful if you're trying to start a business, the fact is you're not sure who to go to first, and they don't always interact with each other. So I would want to hire business navigators that are able to speak different languages to help small businesses get going. I'm also a big proponent of lean urbanism. There's a project on the east side going on right now where they've got some grants to look at some of the regulations that small businesses have to comply with, and to see if there's any kind of loosening up of some of those regulations that they can use not only for that area, but they can use for other areas. So lean urbanism is another thing. I'm also interested in forming partnerships with the unions around a specific initiative. And that is around the research that Bruce Corey has done at Concordia University, looking at where the high demand jobs are and where immigrants intersect with them. And actually, the number one thing that is needed in the Twin Cities right now are RNs. And I have talked with the unions about what kind of outreach they are doing in immigrant communities to try and help immigrants know what the jobs are that are out there, and also then align their education so that they can get those jobs.
All right. In the city of St. Paul on the east side, violent crime and murder rates have now escalated to the point where it's almost equal to North Minneapolis. Might be a number of reasons why, but as the next mayor, and what would you do to help curb that crime? And I believe we are at Melvin.
Melvin. Yeah.
That's an important conversation. You know, every goal that we have as our city starts with making sure that our families and our children and our businesses are safe. That's really critical. As the son of a retired St. Paul police officer, I literally grew up inside the culture of our St. Paul Police Department. And this is something that's very personal and important to me. We have to make sure that our police and our fire have the resource, our fire department have the resources that they need to provide high quality public safety services in every neighborhood. We have to make sure that those violent crimes that you're talking about, there's a relatively small group of people who are responsible for them. We have to work to disrupt those groups, to connect those young people to opportunities so that they can see themselves with a better life, to make sure that we're diverting people who have mental health and substance abuse issues away from our jails and into the treatment that they need. And we have to make doing all of that requires high quality relationships between our community and our officers. It requires a police department that reflects the diversity of our city, and at all of those things together require strong focus by a mayor for whom this is a top priority.
Pat?
These are issues that go to the foundation of a community, and I share what Melvin just said. It is about making sure that our police department and our fire department are fully staffed, equipped. When budget times will get difficult, as they likely will, and when they've been difficult, we need to have focused resources on the police and fire department. We need to support our neighborhood organizations. We need to be out in our neighborhood. We need to continue to support education in our schools, and we need to make sure that what we've all been talking about, which is jobs. And when the economy is strong, things get better. And so we have to be focused on those individuals. And Melvin's correct, small groups of individuals committing these violent crimes. Our police department has to be prepared and ready for that. We have one of the finest police departments in the nation, and I think they're doing a great job. But continuing to focus on that and making sure that young people have access to jobs, good education, and good jobs in our city.
Thank you.
Councilman?
So I think that, I think we're good at addressing or figuring out what the problem is, but I think the question here is why. Why are we having issue on the east side? Well, the reason is because the resource has been taken away from that community, and when you take resource away from that community, where are they going to go? Right? When you take away the jobs, when you take away the after-school program, the parking rack, where are these kids going to go? So what we got to do is we got to put the resource back in the neighborhood. We got to create space and opportunity for them to be in front of adults who cares about them, who can help them with their everyday situation. And then we got to bring the light industrial job back into the neighborhood so that the parents can work in the neighborhood so they can spend more time with their kids. Now, one initiative I'm going to do is I call it the Mayor 100, and I'm going to recruit college students from the university and colleges to come into the neighborhood to work with our kids, to teach them what they are learning in college, and to teach our kids in our neighborhood so that they can invest in our community and so that they can get married, start a life, buy a home in our community. And it's a system that it's long term, but the first we got to address is that we've been taking too much resource from the east side.
Thank you. Elizabeth?
Less than 0.2% times are times where the police actually need to use force to deal with a situation, which I don't, that this is what Chief Axtell told me recently. So I believe that an awful lot of creating safety in the neighborhoods is actually, it's obviously community policing and establishing good relationships, but it's also bringing the community together to explore questions of what makes them feel more safe and what makes them feel less safe. I was at a community group over on the west side at Neighborhood House a few weeks ago, and that was what the community policing effort was. It was bringing together the neighborhood into one room and having them sit at tables, have off-duty police officers, who are not in uniform, sit and have the kinds of conversations about how do we create safety in the neighborhood And when does safety go away? How can we help each other remain safe?
Thank you. Tom.
Well, I think the first question is, why is it happening? We can speculate, but if there's been a specific bump in crime on the East Side, what's going on? Is it gangs coming in from Chicago? Is it a newly formed gang? Is it, you know, ethnic strife? What specifically is the problem? Obviously, we have to have a short-term approach, which is to deal with the violence and try to stop it. That's what the police are there for. But then we have to look at the longer-term approach, which I think is where we've been missing, which is not adequate resources, not having adequate resources for the community, not having the established relationship. Police officers who are active in the community and know who's there are going to know who the good guys are and the bad guys are. If they're not engaged, we may not really know the source. And there has been some bad intelligence and good intelligence. And so the first thing we have to find out is, why is this specifically this happening? And then look at the academic issues of education and job creation and all the other things we've been talking about, and make sure we're pursuing them. Because often we just deal with the problem. You know, we react. We don't deal with the proactive approach to how we're going to solve the long-term issues.
Right. All right. Thank you. If you're just tuning in now, you're listening to Hmong FM, where we give you a glimpse into the Hmong American experience. And we've been talking with the five candidates, the five mayoral candidates for St. Paul tonight. If you want to hear the show over and over and over again, you can always catch it archived at www.kfai.org. If you're just tuning in now, you're listening to Hmong FM, where we give you a glimpse into the Hmong American experience, and we've been talking with the five candidates, the five mayoral candidates of St. Paul tonight. You can always catch our shows archived at www.kfai.org. Support for this program comes from KFAI listener members and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. You know, on the break, Steve from SPNN chimed in with a very important question. So, is the Ford site a thing?
To preface, the Ford plant used to create the Ford Ranger for many, many years and had hundreds and hundreds of jobs. And Ford pulled the plug on it all of a sudden, and now it's a big empty site. So, the question is.
Yeah. What does it mean to you?
And we're starting with Pat this time.
Thank you. To answer the question simply, Ford is a huge thing.
Yeah.
You know, I represented that neighborhood on the city council for a dozen years. You know, we worked with the mayor and the state of Minnesota to try to preserve those jobs at the Ford plant, and Ford decided to close the plant. I helped to create, with Mayor Coleman and I, created the Ford Task Force. We sought funding to do traffic studies, to look at a variety of options for the site, to look at other developments. All with the focus on this one, you know, opportunity that St. Paul has to do something very, very special. It's nearly 148 acres of space. I believe strongly that you know, we set the task force up to look at options. It can't be a site that's too dense and that puts too much traffic in our neighborhoods. There has to be green space in there, both active and passive green space in there. You get one shot at something like this in an entire lifetime. There has to be some development there, but it's very, very important that the site be balanced to provide jobs, to provide housing, to provide seniors the option with housing, but not to be so dense that our neighborhoods are inundated with cars. It's a very isolated site without a lot of access other than a few roads. You know, Ford was there really before a lot of the neighborhoods were there. And so the neighborhood was built up around it. The task force was set up specifically to look at environmental issues, including, you know, contamination in green space and things like that, jobs, traffic. It's a group of incredibly committed neighbors. The city's going through a process right now, but it is absolutely cognizant that we look at this thing, that I am cognizant, and it's absolutely imperative that this is a big thing. In that the surrounding neighborhood and is taken into the foremost consideration, because we have an opportunity to do something incredibly special here, and there must be green space in this property. There must be development, and it must be something that really fits in the fabric of our community.
Thank you. Councilmember Dai?
I think that one of the most important things that the next mayor needs to do is to hold four accountable to help with some of the cleanup. There's a huge environmental contamination in that area, and so we need to hold them accountable to that. The other thing is that we need to make sure that there's enough green space there for future generation to enjoy the river area. The other thing that we need to focus on is, because it is a TIF district, that means that we got to make sure that there's affordable housing there, make sure that people from across the city could live there and afford to live there if they wanted to. At the same time, we need to respect the character and the desire of the neighbors and folks that are living near there, that we have to carefully listen to them and to hear them so that we can design this and build it out in a way that people want to continue to live there and to work there. I think that here's a real opportunity for us to, one of the idea that I like to have a conversation with the community is that what if we build a, I would love to be a part of finding private dollar to build a mural there to tell the story of the Eastsider, I'm sorry, the Highlander, and their story, their immigrant story leading up to where we are today, and that mural should be facing the east to face the sun, and then to the south of that is to recognize the important people that has helped St. Paul and to help the Highland area. I think that that's important because Highland plays an extremely important role in the city of St. Paul, and we need to respect that. We need to recognize that. At the same time, we need to make sure that this is not just built for Highlander, but and to reflect the entire city of St. Paul.
All right. Thank you. Elizabeth?
I was at a meeting this past week with the community about the Ford site, and we had the plans as best they can put right now without a developer out there. And one of the things that I think I'm concerned about and a lot of the residents are concerned about is that the development doesn't drive the zoning, but that the zoning drives the development. And so that the neighborhood's wish for having this actually integrated into the whole of Highland be respected. And especially when you start talking about the heights of the buildings and especially where the affordable housing would be on the outsides of it, there's a lot of concern about those getting to be too tall and blocking views. And one of the interesting ideas that people started talking about, which I hadn't heard and I'd love to see integrated, was the idea of micro apartments, talking about millennials not being as concerned about owning lots of things and wanting smaller spaces and then larger common areas. And I thought that was a very interesting way of potentially keeping the height down so that you get smaller apartments in, you know, a more spread out space, and that might be a way of addressing affordability. And I'm completely behind the idea of making sure that there's adequate green space. One of the things that I'd like to see as someone with an environmental focus is to see that these are the most environmentally friendly buildings that are built, and that there's a significant amount of renewable energy, that things are all as energy efficient as possible, so that they and so that they can last for, you know, 150 years like some of our housing stock now, but in a much more environmentally friendly way. And the other thing I'm very concerned about is TIF money, and make sure that we don't use TIF money like candy to attract developers. This site has enough inherent amenities and inherent advantages that we should be very careful the way we use it.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Tom.
So I think the Ford site represents a huge opportunity that we have to get right, but I also think it presents something of a conundrum. We have the city wanting to have a very dense project. We have the neighbors wanting to see a lot of uses there, but not wanting a lot of traffic. We have needs for affordable housing. There's been a lot of community discussion, very in-depth, but, you know, everybody's got a piece of what they'd like to see. And, you know, one of my concerns is that we gave up a huge manufacturing capacity, which we're not replacing, that wasn't really a consideration. The other thing is the idea of this being a campus for, you know, a large business or several businesses where you would still be able to get the tax base but not have the kind of traffic issues. The fact that we really ruled those out, because I think St. Paul, you know, we can build a lot of housing in Highland, but if it's going to be just for wealthy people, where are the jobs? Where are the people, you know, going to be able to afford to live there if they don't have jobs? So what I think we need to do with that site is, I co-founded a campaign called Connect St. Paul about universal broadband. That has to be a piece of this development, has to be a piece of what we do in the Midway as well, where broadband is the future and solving the digital divide has to be part of what we do as a city, so we are not left behind. We're not having those discussions, and we should be, and I've been pushing to have them. We also, solar employs more people than any other industry combined. Woo-hoo! In the energy sector. We need to have solar in, that has to be a major solar investment there. It may jumpstart solar in the city. Those are the kind of jobs we can create that it can allow people to afford things. Because it's one thing to build affordable housing, but it's another for people to have the jobs even to be able to afford the affordable housing. So we need a comprehensive approach that looks at job creation, because I don't want to just see a bunch of retail that does not create livable wage jobs be there that's more convenient, and then a lot of housing that ends up really being luxury housing because developers mm-hmm. would love to run houses, you know, million-dollar homes all along there, and it's pretty attractive because, you know, talking about the property tax base, if this is the most desirable site in the Midwest as it's been touted, we should not be using TIF to fund the development there.
Thank you. All right, Mr. Carter.
Redeveloping the Ford plant, in short, is one of the greatest opportunities that we have in front of us as a city right now. All in one parcel, we have an opportunity to create affordable housing and add housing units in our community. We have an opportunity to create living wage job opportunities for our residents, and we have to do that in the context of honoring our river and also honoring the community that the Ford plant is in. That's very important to me as a descendant of our old Rondo community that was uprooted when the freeway came through. We have to honor our community that we're in. As mayor, I will make sure that we create accountability provisions so that when city funding is involved or when city variances are needed, we're creating contractual obligations to provide jobs for St. Paul residents and to provide affordable housing units. That's very critical. I do share the concern about the traffic load, and I think the answer to that isn't to create a cap on density. We need to make sure that we take advantage of the opportunity we have in the Ford plant to add to our tax base and stimulate growth. One of the things that I've spent a lot of time working on is transit and bike paths and making sure that we're creating a walkable city. And as we do that, we connect, we not only build the Ford plant as a wonderful paradise island in our community, we connect it to the rest of our community so that people on the east side can get to those jobs, so that people who live there can get to jobs along University Avenue, and so that we're really building one community, that we're really doing this in a way that benefits our entire city and not just one neighborhood or even just the folks who live and work on that site.
All right, wow. Like somebody mentioned, the Highland area is just one example of the many, many things that you guys will be having to deal with as mayor. Mm-hmm.
You are listening to Hmong FM, where we give you a glimpse into the Hmong American experience, and we've been talking with the five mayoral candidates in St. Paul, Dai Thao, Elizabeth Dickinson, Tom Goldstein, Melvin Carter III, and Pat Harris have spent the last hour and a half with us, almost an hour and a half. We're down to the last 5 minutes, and we want to end this on a really, really positive note, although I think it's been overwhelmingly really positive tonight. I'm going to have to listen to this again. We've learned a lot about you all tonight, but we want to ask you to share with us before we leave. What is
the one single life achievement that you are most proud of? And Dai, we start with you.
You know, I think for me, it would be the opportunity to serve the people of St. Paul. You know, coming here as a political refugee, and seeing how what we learned. The city of St. Paul has done so good, has been so good to the Hmong people, the Hmong community. The Hmong community have learned so much from the African-American community, the Irish, the German. And I'm just so thankful to be an American. I'd rather be in this country than in Laos. I love it here. I'm so glad that, and I'm so grateful that our sponsor sponsored our family. They took a leap of faith in our family to invest in us and to bring us here. And the best thing that I could do is that when I'm old and I'm on my bed, I could look back and say, you know what? I gave everything I could. I gave everything I got to the people of St. Paul, to the city of St. Paul, to the United States of America. That's going to be my most greatest achievement.
All right, Elizabeth.
I've led a varied life, and I'm not a career politician, so I think I'm proud of the variety of experiences. I'm proud of helping clean up the local coal-burning plants. I'm proud of helping to increase educational standards when I worked for the PTA. I'm proud of working on healthy legacy to try and get harmful chemicals out of consumer products. I'm proud of helping to pass the smoking ban. I'm proud of my work as a coach in trying to help people figure out what they want and construct a plan to get it. I think any time that I can help take away barriers for people so that they can succeed, it's a good day. And that's what I'd like to do for St. Paul. Thank you.
All right, Tom.
So I'm going to split this up into personal and professional. You know, my most singular, most positive achievement is raising my son, who is a remarkable 24-year-old young man working in New York and asking great questions and working within the political sphere and trying in his own way to change things. And I'm very proud of everything that he's done and the fact that he has a very critical mind and is thinking of how he can make the world a better place. And, you know, for myself, I think like Elizabeth, I've had a lot of life experiences that people can read about on my website. I think professionally, being a voice in the midst of all these stadium boondoggles, all the enormous resources that could have gone to so many more important things that have been instead diverted into the pockets of millionaires and billionaires, I was often the lone voice for almost a decade fighting against that. And I think it inspired some people to stand up and take on battles in their community, because I think we will eventually see that the benefits to this were negligible compared to the cost to the community. So if that's one legacy I have, that one person who maybe couldn't win the battle at least stood up and inspired other people to take on those battles.
Thank you. Melvin?
I'll agree with Tom that there's nothing in my life that compares to how proud I am of my children and the incredible life partner I get to spend the rest of my life with. Professionally speaking, I'm very humbled and proud of the opportunity to have served Ward 1 on the St. Paul City Council. I'm proud of the work that we did to create the St. Paul Promise neighborhood, which has grown into a $20 million investment in child and family success. I'm proud of the work that we did to reorganize our city's Department of Human Rights and Equal Economic Opportunity to make sure that we built a strong champion to make sure that every community in our city has equal access to the economic opportunities that our city creates. And I'm very, very proud of the work we did to build the Green Line light rail in a way that serves our neighborhoods with local stops, local hiring, and local contracting. What I'm most proud of is not having done any of those things by myself. I'm most proud of having been able to use City Hall as a platform to bring people together and to allow them to build the city of their future.
Thank you. Pat.
And for me, it's also my family. You know, being able to be a partner with my wonderful wife, Laura, and to be able to raise four children, Daniel, Ellie, Joey, and Andrew, it's an honor, and it's incredible, and I love it each and every day. You know, professionally, I've been involved in numerous things, the Serving Our Troops program that serves 90,000 steaks to soldiers and families of the Minnesota National Guard has received numerous accolades, two Emmys. You know, I received the Lifetime of Service Award from Catholic Charities. But one of the proudest things I have is, you know, when I got elected the first time to City Council, my mother said, you know, you be good to my libraries. And I did good. And the Friends of the St. Paul Public Library has an award called the Pat Harris Award, and I was just honored to be able to receive that. And it's just that type of work professionally is I'm very proud of.
Thank you. Thank you all so much for spending this last hour and a half with us. If you're just tuning in now, you've missed our show, but you can always catch it archived at www.kfai.org. Just a quick reminder to everyone that we have ranked choice voting in St. Paul. Mm-hmm. And so in November, when you go to the ballot, you'll get to pick not only one, your first choice, but you'll also get to rank your choices. You can learn more information at fairvoteminnesota.org. And quick thank yous to Dale Connelly, our program director, Leah Honsky, the KFAI general manager, our engineers for tonight, Wyatt Sparber, Rajib Bahar, Alex Hartmann, and then thank you very much to Steve Brunsberg and Cara Hawkinson from SPNN. Thank you to all of our candidates. See you at...
thank you.
Yes,
thank
no
you.
Problem. And there's another forum in Ward 6 this weekend, correct?
Sunday.
Sunday. Yep. All right, see you there.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Yes.